Have you heard the story of the husband whose wife ran away, not just once, but twice, into a life of prostitution? After refusing the pleas of her family to return, she sold herself into slavery. But her husband, ever faithful, paid the price to buy her back. Welcome to Through the Bible with our teacher, Dr. J. Vernon McGee. And the story of that runaway bride and her faithful husband is one that we'll hear today as the final part of Dr. McGee's intro to the book of Hosea. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word that tells us of your grace that saves us. Open our hearts to hear your timeless message of mercy today, no matter how far away we've run. In Jesus' precious loving name we pray. Amen. Here's Through the Bible with Dr. J. Vernon McGee.
I probably should have said this last time, but I want to say it today. The message that you will listen to today, the conclusion of it, was a sermon I gave some time ago. But you must remember it's a sermon and not just a Bible study. There are those that think that my method of preaching and my method of teaching is entirely different. I never felt so myself personally, but if you distinguish that difference, it's simply because of the fact that this was a sermon that was given before a congregation of, I'm confident, 3,000 or more people besides a radio audience at that time. Now, I want to come back and talk a little about this man, Hosea, because we are going to talk about him again in the message today. But I want to think of him in connection with the prophet Jeremiah. As we indicated last time, Jeremiah stood actually at the very end of the time of the nation Judah. He predicted their captivity, and they went into captivity. Hosea is the prophet to the northern kingdom, and actually, he prophesied long before Jeremiah, and he said practically the same thing to them. You find that the experience of these men are very similar in many ways. Both of these men spoke with a broken heart. Jeremiah was told never to marry. He was commanded not to. He loved his nation and he loved his people. And he spoke of a broken heart. The message he gave broke his heart. And God wanted that kind of a man because it revealed how God felt toward them. Now, Hosea apparently was a different type of a man. And his is not a public experience. His is a very personal and very private experience. He comes out of a broken home, as we shall see today, and with tear-stained eyes went before the nation to tell the nation that what had happened to him in his home was exactly what was happening out there in the nation. And he had a broken heart, and he knew exactly how God felt toward these people. And you're going to find out in this prophecy here, the great theme that he uses is return unto the Lord. And you find that, for instance, in Hosea, the 6th chapter, verse 1, come, and let us return unto the Lord, for he hath torn, and he will heal us. He hath smitten, he'll bind us up. And the word return occurs 15 times in this prophecy. Ephraim occurs 36 times, and that is the name, and I would say sort of a personal, tender name in a way that God had for the northern kingdom, though they had gone into idolatry. Now, he mentions backsliding. It occurs 3 times in this prophecy. And we're going to find out what backsliding really is. And there's another word that's greatly misunderstood in the church today. And so Jeremiah, we saw before, he mentioned it. Hosea and Jeremiah are the two prophets who talk about backsliding and the cure for it. And therefore, what Jeremiah was to Judah at the time of the captivity of the southern kingdom, Hosea was to Israel over a century before at the time of the captivity of the northern kingdom. Both spoke out of a heartbreaking personal experience. And now we are ready to hear the last part of the message that we gave last time.
In the hill country of Ephraim, in one of the many little towns there, a little town that's not on the maps of this world, there lived two young people. One was a boy by the name of Hosea. The other was a girl by the name of Gomer. They fell in love. Same old story. It's been repeated thousands and thousands and millions of times. I don't think it's stretching the imagination to say that they fell madly in love with each other. And then, for some unaccountable reason, Gomer went bad. She resorted even to the oldest profession that's known to mankind. Gomer had done the things she should not have done, and Hosea was brokenhearted, shame filled his soul, and he had recourse to the Mosaic law, and he could have taken her before the elders of the city and had her stoned to death. Does that remind you of another story that took place 700 years later in that same hill country, when a man by the name of Joseph was engaged to a girl by the name of Mary? The only thing is, Joseph was wrong, and the angel had to appear to him. This man Hosea was right, for Gomer was guilty. And it's at this particular juncture that the book of Hosea opens. Will you listen now to the second verse of the first chapter, the beginning of the word of the Lord by Hosea? And the Lord said to Hosea, go take unto thee a wife of whoredoms and children of whoredoms, for the land hath committed great whoredom departing from the Lord. Now, there have been those today that have made the statement that what you have here is nothing in the world but an allegory, that this really never happened. May I say that such trifling as that with the Word of God waters it down till it becomes a harmless sort of thing and meaningless, and it's sickening. May I say to you that this is something that actually happened. Let's face it. God commanded this man, Hosea, to break the Mosaic law and go marry this woman. He said, you go get her and marry her. The law said stone her. God said marry her. The thing God commanded to this man, Hosea, to do must have caused him to revolt in every fiber of his being. But this man, Hosea, did not demur. He obeyed God wholly and completely and explicitly, and he went and took Gomer in holy wedlock. He gave her his name, and she came into his home. And listen to the Apostle Paul as he speaks of this. What? Know ye not that he which is joined to a harlot is one body? For two saith he shall be one flesh. And my friend, in that little town, the tempo of gossip was really picked up. Oh, I tell you, that home of Hosea became a desert island in a sea of criticism. It was an isolation ward of local society. A case of leprosy in the home would not have broken off contact any more effectively than this thing that had happened. Imagine this man marrying this woman. Children were born into the home. Three of them were born. And let me tell you, there's meaning here. Jezreel was the name of the first one. It means God will scatter and God will avenge. The reference, as God told Hosea, was directly to the house of Jehu, who had carried out God's instructions in destroying the house of Ahab, but he'd done it in hatred, and he'd done it with great personal vengeance. And God says, I'll judge. But then he says, I will scatter Israel, but there's going to be mercy even in my judgment. That's the first child. The second child was named, she was a girl, Lo Ruhamah, and it means she never knew a father's pity. Now, that doesn't mean she was an orphan. It means she didn't know who her father was. This woman has started to go bad again. God is saying to these people in Hosea's day, the northern kingdom that now has gone into idolatry, you will not know my pity, for I'm not your father. And that brings us to the last child. What a story is here. Lo Ami was the name of the last boy. It means not my people. If you want to put it in the singular, it's not my child. Hosea said, I didn't know about the second one, but I do know about the third one. I'm not the father, not my child. What a message. What a message to that day, and what a message to this day. The liberal today says, everybody's the son of God. God says, you're wrong. I have no illegitimate children. I know who my children are. You think my children are the offspring of this kind of a union? Absolutely not. You are only my child through faith in Jesus Christ. And it was the Lord Jesus that said to these in his day who said, we're sons of Abraham. He said, you are of your father, the devil. You could make no claim of being God's child. My friend this morning, are you lo ami? Are you God's child today? Are you just an illegitimate child? You're just saying something that's not true. You become a child of God. To as many as received him, that is the Lord Jesus, to them gave he the right, the authority, to become the sons of God, even to those that don't do any more nor less than believe on his name. This is a sad story, is it not? And to cap it all, Gomer left home. She ran away. Now I'm confident that you're willing to say, well, certainly God's going to say to this man now, you've done all you can, Hosea. You tried to reform the woman, and it didn't do any good. She's returned back to her old life of becoming a common prostitute. Take the children and leave her. God says, go get her. Hosea went after her, and she wouldn't come back. God says, send the children. And these three children went after her, and she still wouldn't come back. And as women did in that day, they sold themselves into slavery. And this man, Hosea, went and bought her and brought her back. Oh, my beloved, what a picture of a Savior today. He created us, and we belong to him. And then we're guilty of going off and giving our love and our affection, our time to the sin of the world. And in the midst of that, when we were yet sinners, he came down and bought us with a price in our ugly condition that he might make us his legitimate children. What love. And so it was at this particular juncture when she came back that the message goes out from Hosea. I wish this morning I could say that when she came back, that she became a faithful wife. I can't. I do not know. The book leaves us in doubt. But I do know this, that this man stepped out of a home scarred by shame. This man went before a nation with a heart that was breaking. This man had a message that had fire in it. He stood before this nation with a broken heart, and he had a sorrow that was intolerable. Scalding tears were coursing down his cheek, and he denounced the nation Israel, and he says, you have been faithless to God. I know how God feels. I feel the same way. You've broken the heart of God. What a picture. He denounced the nation. He declared a verdict of guilty for the crime of all crimes. He said simply, but he said it specifically, that this sin was as black as it could be and that God would punish. He said this nation that had known God, this nation that God had redeemed out of Egypt, this nation that he could say, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians, I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. And they turn right around and make a golden calf. And they hadn't learned their lesson after that experience, for at this very moment, in the northern kingdom, two golden calves had been made, and the people had turned from the living and true God. God says, you've been unfaithful. You're playing the harlot. Turn from me. You belong to me. I have redeemed you, and you've sinned. This sin is the worst sin in the world. Oh, I know that there are folk that'll say this morning, I think unbelief is the greatest sin. May I say to you that in one sense, unbelief is the greatest sin. If there's any sin unpardonable, it's unbelief. But it's not an act, it's a state, and we're all born in it. Rebellion against God, we're in that. But thank God, it's pardonable. Christ died that when you and I will exercise faith in Jesus Christ, then he'll save us. And this sin is pardonable. But unbelief is a terrible thing, and to go on in unbelief, there is no remedy, for it is. The remedy is to trust Christ. And when we continue on in unbelief, we've rejected the remedy. Then there are those that will tell you today that the greatest sin in the world is sin against light. Well, this is coming close to it. I'll be perfectly frank with you. I do not think today that there's anything quite so bad as sinning against light. I make this statement periodically. Let me repeat it. I would 10,000 times rather be a Hottentot in the darkest part of Africa this morning than to be sitting in the Church of the Open Door and turn my back on Jesus Christ. There are people that will argue with you about what's going to happen to the Hottentot, but no one can argue from the Word of God what will happen to the man who sins against light. That's a great sin to have heard the gospel, and it's not a personal. We'll be able to go out of here this morning and go into the presence of Jesus Christ and say you never heard that he died for you and that you're to trust him to be saved. You'll never be able to. There are people that are able to go into his presence and say that, but that's not the greatest sin. What is the greatest sin in all the world? The greatest sin in all the world is sin against love. This is sin that's worse. You can't get any worse than this. This is the greatest of all. And that, my friend, is the message of Hosea. Gomer was not only guilty of breaking the marriage vow, that's bad enough, but she sinned against the one who loved her. That's sin at its worst. May I say to you today, to sin against God today and a Savior that loves you is worse than the animism and the animalism of the heathen world today. May I say to you, the sin today of paganism is nothing compared to the sin of those. Sin against love. It's deeper and it's darker than the immorality of the underworld and the demonism of the overworld. Hosea knew what sin was, and he knew what love was. And sin against love aggravates sin. Israel knew the love of God, as no nation did. You alone, God said, have I known of the nations of the world, you alone have I revealed this. You've sinned. But thank God, he's going to triumph. May I just lift out in closing three verses out of Hosea that tell God's story. The first is Hosea 4:17, Ephraim is joined to idols, let him alone. Ephraim is Israel. That's the charge. Spiritual adultery. Then notice, though, all the great pulsating passion of an infinite God. How shall I give thee up, Ephraim? How shall I deliver thee, Israel? God says, I can't give you up. I love you too much. And that's the reason he sent Hosea back to get that woman the second and the third time. He said, Hosea, you'll have to know how I feel. Go with Israel. And then the third and the last is Hosea 14:8. Ephraim shall say, what have I to do anymore with idols? I have heard him and observed him. I'm like a green fir tree. For me is thy fruit found. That's the victory. God's going to get the victory, my beloved. There is a day when Israel will turn from idols back to God. And that's my reason for believing that maybe Gomer did turn and become a good wife and a good mother. I do not know, but I do know this: God is going to triumph. And the picture is the picture of the nation Israel. Somebody says, does it has any application to us today? Yes. Does this shocking description of spiritually adultery, does it fit the church today? Well, the church is called the bride of Christ. Paul said to the Corinthians, I have espoused you, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. The church is to be presented to the Lord Jesus Christ as a bride. Listen, even to the church in Ephesus, the Lord Jesus Christ says, I have something against you. Now he says, I know your works and I know your labor. And I know that you can't bear those with false doctrine. But I have this against you. You have left your first love. My friend, it's not enough this morning to be busy for Christ. It's not enough to be active today for Christ. And it's not enough to be just fundamental. Those things are important and they have their place. But the important thing is, have you left your first love? Do you love him today? Hosea means salvation. It's the same word as Joshua, and Joshua is the same word as Jesus in the New Testament. Our Hosea today is joined to a spiritual harlot. Picture that is given in Revelation 17, it's the most frightful picture in the Bible. It's a picture of a church called the great harlot, Mystery Babel. That's the way the organized church is going today. Oh, how many this morning are covering up their frustration, their lack of spiritual experience today, the reality, by just being busy. It's merely nothing in the world but just nervous agitation. Down underneath, they cannot say, I love him. I'm true to him. With hot tears today, he accuses the church of being lukewarm. God pity the man married the lukewarm woman. God pity our Savior today, joined to a church that's just lukewarm. Oh, that he said, I wish you were hot or cold. I wish you were in love with me. I wish you did care for me above everything. That's what he said. Let me be very personal this morning. How about you? Has there come between the Savior this morning and your soul a cloud? It'll shut you away from him, I'll tell you that. Spurgeon was crossing the street one day, and he stopped and had prayer. And when he got the other side, a friend said to him, what in the world did you do praying in the middle of the street? He said, a cloud came between my soul and Christ, and I couldn't let it stay there even till I got to the other side of the street. How about you today? He says this morning, as he said yonder by the Sea of Galilee, lovest thou me? That's all important. May I say that it's so important today that he is saying, herein is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son be the propitiation, the mercy seat for our sins. And if you are here this morning without Christ, don't take any comfort from this message, because you can walk out of here turning your back on a Savior that just simply said, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. When you reject Jesus Christ today, you're not just doing something that's bad. You're not just turning away in unbelief. My friend, you're committing the greatest sin of all. You're turning away from a God who loves you and died for you. There's no sin like that.
Have you turned away from the God who loves you? If so, he'll give you another chance. You can learn more about the grace that God offers you through his Son, Jesus Christ, when you visit ttb.org and click on How Can I Know God? Or call us today at 1-800-65-BIBLE, and we'll send a few of these resources to you by mail. And join us tomorrow as Dr. McGee steers the Bible bus straight into Hosea chapter 1. I'm Steve Schwetz, and I'll be saving a seat on the Bible bus just for you.
Sin had left a crimson stain.
Today's study with Dr. J. Vernon McGee is brought to you by Thru the Bible, and it's made possible by the generous prayer and financial investments from listeners like you on the Bible bus all around the world.